This is Herb Kressel, and welcome to the May 2014 Radiology Podcast. This month, we have three very fascinating papers that we'll be highlighting. First, I'll be speaking with Dr. Jeffrey Weinreb, who with colleagues at Yale University School of Medicine reported on the radiation dose index of a renal colic protocol CT scans in the United States, looking at the American College of Radiology National Radiology Data Registry. And Dr. Weinreb, who's one of the authors, will be joined by Dr. James Brink, radiologist in chief at Massachusetts General Hospital, who has been heading up the Image Wisely campaign, and who wrote an editorial on this thought-provoking paper. Then my colleague, Dr. Albert DeRoos, our deputy editor for cardiovascular imaging, will speak with Anna Zavodni of the University of Toronto, who was the first author on a paper which is part of the MESA, Multi-Ethnic Study of Atherosclerosis. And they looked at carotid artery plaque morphology and composition in relationship to incident cardiovascular events. We're all looking for biomarkers of disease that can be used to stratify risk. And I think this paper is kind of very interesting in this regard. And finally, I'll be speaking with Drs. Armin Nagel and Professor Marc-André Weber of Heidelberg about their feasibility study on in vivo chloride 35 MR imaging at 7 Tesla. This is a very technically challenging accomplishment, and we'll be talking to them about how they do it and the potential importance of imaging chlorine and chloride in the future. We hope you find this month's podcast stimulating and of interest. This is Herb Kressel, and welcome to the May 2014 Radiology Podcast. Today, we'll be discussing a very thought-provoking paper written by Adam Lukasiewicz and colleagues from the Yale University School of Medicine. The corresponding author of the paper was Dr. Chris Moore. And today we're joined by a member of the author group, Professor Jeffrey Weinreb, who's professor of radiology at the Yale University School of Medicine, and who also sits as chair of the steering committee for Radiology Data Registry at the American College of Radiology. Welcome, Dr. Weinreb. Joining us today as well is Dr. Jim Brink, who is radiologist in chief at Mass General Hospital and the Juan M. Tavares Chair, professor of radiology at the Harvard School of Medicine. Jim co-chairs Image Wisely and is the vice president at the National Council of Radiation Protection. As part of this discussion, I need to remind everyone that I also sit on the Joint Task Force for Adult Radiation Protection of the RSNA and the American College of Radiology. And the paper we're going to talk about is entitled A Radiation Dose Index of Renal Colic Protocol CT Scans in the United States, a report from the American College of Radiology National Radiology Data Registry. Welcome, Dr. Weinreb.
Thank you, Herb.
And welcome, Dr. Brink.
Thank you, nice to be here.
Great. This, I think, will be kind of a very interesting discussion. And could you start, Dr. Weinreb, by telling us, why did you and your colleagues actually decide to do this study?
Well, first of all, this was a team effort between the Department of Radiology and the Emergency Medicine Department. And there's a recognition that a renal colic protocol CT scan is a very common procedure. So there's millions of them performed in the United States each year. So this represents a significant radiation burden to the population. It's also an area where it's known that there are low-dose protocols that can lower the dose of radiation compared to what has been routinely done around the country. And yet there's really very little data about what people are doing. So it seemed like an opportunity with the dose index registry from the ACR, the DIR, to gather data about what's going on around the country, see what kind of doses are being used for renal colic protocols, how many places have actually instituted low-dose protocols, and also focus on our own institution where we have a low-dose protocol doing, and compare it to the rest of the country.
Now, could you tell us a little more about the ACR dose registry? What is it? Who participates in it?
Registries are a well-accepted and proven methodology for improving quality and safety in medicine. The American College of Radiology Dose Index Registry, or DIR, is one of a number of national radiology registries administered by the ACR. This was an initiative which was the brainchild of Harvey Nieman, and it was launched in May 2011 as a means of collecting dose indices for specific CT examinations in individual patients from participating institutions and providing feedback about the collective radiation exposure relative to peer institutions in the region and around the country. Participation is voluntary, and the process is now fully automated and uses standard methods of data collection and processing. So far, almost 900 facilities have registered, and about 530 of them are actually contributing data. And there are more than 14 million CT scans in the registry database so far. So this is really the first opportunity to see what doses are actually being used for specific CT exams and to compare institutions and regions around the country.
And what exactly are these diagnostic reference levels? How would you use them? What does it mean?
Well, there's a lot of data being recorded, but the main indices that are being used are the CTDI-VOL and the DLP. And these give you an indication of the dose that the CT scanner is producing for particular types of examinations.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what did you actually find?
Well, very interesting. First of all, there's tremendous variation, fivefold variation across the country in the median doses being used for this particular study for renal colic protocol. And that percent of the exam using what we would call a low dose this opportunity for just in this one particular. Also, this by saying that this data was acquired up until January of 2013, and it only included around 250 some odd sites around the country. And just to put that in context, that's 93 facilities around the country. There are, I think, around 13 CT scanners. So this acquired the data that was available at the time, but it is data from mostly from 2012, and mm-hmm. it's on a self-selected group of participants, probably those who think that they're doing well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Jim, do you find these results surprising or not surprising?
I would say they're disappointing and perhaps not too surprising. And I think it's because although we've been focusing on increasing awareness and education, we really haven't been focusing so much on ensuring adoption of best practices. I do think probably the next effort that our profession should focus on is really about reducing variation among practices.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that you and your colleagues found in the study, Jeff, was that the doses on the West Coast were lower. And I'm certainly, many of us are aware of the California as sort of the first state to enact regulations mandating that the doses be collected and made available. Do you think that the state regulations could be the reason for some of these changes, that the differences?
Well, I think, first of all, it's not surprising to see regional variations because there are seem to be regional variations in many areas of medicine. As to why the doses in this particular protocol might be lower on the West Coast, I think it's purely speculation. And frankly, I don't know that it's tied into the regulations in California. It might be due, just as an example, to body habitus. Maybe people are thinner on the West Coast, and if they're, you know, if you have people with higher body mass indices, that maybe they're getting higher doses in other parts of the country. It could be due to the equipment. It could be due to any number of factors. I think what's great about the DIR is, for the first time, it allows us to identify these variations and to dig into them and see why they are occurring.
Okay.
Good. Now, Jim, there are some other states that have been contemplating regulation, and there's also sort of recently, I gather, that MEDA has kind of started an initiative relating to equipment use as it may affect dose. Can you tell us about these?
Sure. I think one of the initiatives that some are pursuing, particularly some of the equipment manufacturers, is really trying to ensure that practices and imaging practitioners use equipment that has the latest techniques for dose monitoring, control, and notification. And these initiatives, I think, are targeted toward even potentially inducing financial penalties for those who use aged equipment. I think probably the thing I would focus on more is about really promoting adoption of best practices, as I mentioned before, and I think really regardless of the age of the equipment that one uses, one can achieve low doses in most cases. It may be more difficult to do on older equipment and require more vigilance in terms of making sure that there are manual checks on dose and not relying so much on automated tools, but it's certainly possible to reduce dose even on older equipment. All the more important that we really promulgate the methods to do so and the importance of doing so.
Mm-hmm. I think many sort of find the notion of more government regulation into sort of the delivery of Medicare a little chilling, but I think the results of this study suggest that we certainly need to try to do a better job. There's certainly work in front of us. And one of the other things that came up, I think, in your editorial, Jim, was sort of the issue of not all scans for renal colic are the same, although I guess in the study they focused on the ones in the emergency room. Some are follow-up studies, some are in patients in whom the diagnosis is known, and there's a substantial differential. So first question, do you think you can, I'll ask this to both of you, should we be finely tailoring these and have guidelines for very specific indications, or should we broaden sort of the range that we're accepting, recognizing the inherent variability and need? And if you do that, then how do you really move towards a best practice situation? And Jim, I'll start with you in this, because I assume that you've sort of, in your different roles, have been thinking about this.
Yes, thank you. I in this era of personalized medicine, I think there's no question we need to be more aggressive in personalizing the techniques that we use in imaging. Certainly, when it comes to the renal protocol CT scan, I think that there's been some resistance for adoption because of fear of missing other findings that may have been misinterpreted by ordering physicians as possibly due to kidney or renal stones. And that's sort of the usual argument as to why a practice won't want to adopt a low-dose scan. But if we actually focus on those who are having follow-up imaging for known stone disease, then it would certainly be not unreasonable to adopt a very low-dose scan because we're doing a targeted indication, a targeted scan for a very specific indication.
So, Dr. Weinreb, from your perspective, how do you think about this, sort of the general versus a specific indication, both in terms of practice, but more importantly, in the context of the study, in terms of a dose registry situation?
Well, I think this points out an important point that we want to make sure doesn't get lost. It's not just about dose. It's also, there's got to be a balance between image quality and dose, because we can keep lowering the dose, lower and lower, but at some point it is going to compromise diagnostic capabilities, not just for renal stones, but for all those other findings. After all, when we get patients for a renal colic protocol, a fairly large percentage of them end up not having a renal stone and having some other significant finding. And in fact, we're looking at that data right now, because this whole issue of how low can you go and what are you going to miss, I think is something that we still need a lot to study further before we keep lowering the doses.
I think the other question I wanted to raise to you, Dr. Brink, is what about Image Wisely? How does Image Wisely fit into this picture? Is it doing what it's supposed to be doing? Or should it be doing additional things? Is there a need to sort of bring Image Wisely more closely connected to the dose registry?
That's a great question. Thank you. The Image Wisely launched about 4 years ago, and our initial charge was to raise awareness and provide educational materials and content to practitioners, imaging practitioners and others about adult radiation protection. And we began initially focusing on computed tomography, followed by nuclear medicine, and now we're in the middle of building out content for fluoroscopy. But by the end of this this calendar year, we will have fulfilled our initial charge. And I must tell you that this article and the opportunity to write this editorial really prompted me to propose to our governing boards in the form of a letter I've drafted, hasn't actually gone to the boards yet, but a letter asking for a new charge for Image Wisely to propel us beyond this current year, because we will have fulfilled our initial charge from what we set out to do 4 years ago. And in that proposal, I'm suggesting that, in fact, we need to move to really monitoring adoption of best practices and not just promoting the reduction in variation in how we do our business, but also measuring it and ensuring that we're following the principles of Image Wisely.
And Dr. Weinreb, in the registry, are you made aware if the sites have signed on to Image Wisely or not? Is there any information that you gather that might be useful?
Sure. Well, we know right now there are close to 600 sites participating in the dose index registry, and more than 800 are in the process. If they're not participating, they've registered. They're still getting set up to go. That still leaves a lot of places that are not yet participating. So I think as this is gaining traction, and as more and more facilities become aware of the opportunity that this presents to compare your facility to other places, to use it to lower your dose, I think more and more places are going to participate, and we'll get better and better data.
Okay.
The other question, the broader question that this raises, there's a lot of concern about radiation dose from diagnostic imaging procedures. And, you know, we are, and we put ourselves forth as the stewards of the population in terms of managing this. And so the question that sort of comes to mind, are we actually meeting the public's expectations and sort of organized medicine's expectations? Jim, you mentioned that there's some new JCO requirements in this regard. So I welcome your thoughts on sort of where we stand in terms of our roles as stewards. Jim, do you want to start?
Sure. So this is another very interesting topic because it's easier to be a clear defined steward for something when there's less uncertainty about the topic. And when it comes to dose tracking, this is a particularly, I think, vexing issue because ImageWisely, in partnership with the Food and Drug Administration, made a conscious decision a couple of years ago to track and encourage patients to track their imaging exams, but not to try and actually track specific exposure metrics, mostly because the natural extension of tracking an exposure metric is in the risk estimation. And because risk estimation is so difficult, if not, and so uncertain, particularly when we start talking about cumulative exposures and what the impact of a series of single low-dose exposures it represents versus a larger single high-dose exposure, it becomes much, much more challenging. And my fear is that as we enter doses in the medical record, then there will be a natural tendency to try and make subsequent medical decisions about further imaging based on prior exposures. And that's where the whole system breaks down, because there's really not a person on the planet who can make an unequivocal statement about the risk of a prior exposure relative to future risk, particularly given the uncertainties with respect to age, life expectancy, comorbid conditions. All these things affect risk estimations, and we're just nowhere near in the science to really make those understandings.
Jeff, your thoughts on our sort of role and the registry's role in terms of meeting our responsibility as stewards?
Well, I think, first of all, I think there is a large level of uncertainty. But in the end, for better or worse, I think it's best to have more information and for put more information in the hands of the referring doctors and the patients. And as radiologists, we're the experts on radiation. And that's the role we should be playing. And we have, I think, incumbent on us to make sure that this information is used appropriately and not inappropriately. I don't think it's our role to hoard the information or to keep it in our pockets and not share it. I think it's important that we share the information and make sure that it's used appropriately. I also like to say, I think that, you know, one could argue that in the past, radiologists maybe weren't as engaged in this as much as they should have been. Whether or not that's true, I think there's no question that going forward, we have to take control of this. We have to be the people in charge of this, because if we are not and don't do it well, frankly, there will be more regulations, and that may not be the best way to deal with the radiation issue. Everybody agrees that if we can lower the radiation dose, we should. And we're the ones to do it.
Very good point. I think I'll close with something that a wise man once told me. It was in a different context. If you don't have a seat at the table, you're more likely to be the meal. And I think we really should make sure we have a seat at the table and use our seat wisely. I want to thank both of you for participating in what has been a very, very stimulating discussion. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Herb.
Thank you.
Bye.
Welcome to this podcast. I'm Albert de Roos. I'm the deputy editor for Cardiac Papers for Radiology. And I'm joined today by Dr. Zavodni from the University of Toronto, who has been written with her co-authors an interesting article entitled Carotid Artery Plaque Morphology and Composition in Relationship to Incident Cardiovascular Events, the Multi-Ethnic Study of Atherosclerosis or MESA Trial. Welcome, Dr. Zavodni.
Thank you very much. I'm thrilled to be here.
Thank you. So let's get started to discuss your paper a little bit. I have some general questions and maybe later some more specific questions. Can you give a brief outline of the purpose of your study and what was the underlying assumption and hypothesis you were trying to study?
So the purpose of this paper was to determine whether or not both plaque morphology and remodeling were both important contributors to determining whether or not we can improve our risk prediction in asymptomatic individuals. So in studying a group of patients who were asymptomatic at baseline, we followed them for events, and they were tested in multiple ways, both collecting traditional risk factors, so the Framingham risk factors, including age, blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes status, smoking status, and then seeing whether or not the addition of our sort of very advanced imaging techniques in radiology can contribute to predicting who's going to develop bad cardiovascular events in the long term, things like stroke, heart attack, and so our underlying hypothesis is that we would be able to provide additional prognostic information and sort of hone in on those people that were at highest risk using our advanced techniques.
Okay, thank you. So, and actually you were using different imaging modalities, intima media thickness by ultrasound, as well as a number of measurements by MRI techniques. So to understand these measurements by MRI to better advantage, I like to invite you to explain one of the figures a little bit in more detail to explain which measurements were actually obtained. And I think figure three, which can also be shown in the podcast, gives a good illustration on what you were measuring by MRI in those patients. Can you explain that a little bit?
Sure. And so when we were looking just at the morphology of the plaque or the volume of the plaque, we took some values, including the lumen area. So we contoured the outer aspect of the lumen, and then we took the adventitial layer. And so by doing a comparison of this lumen to outer adventitial ratio, we get a sense of remodeling or the expansion of the plaque. As you know, there's a lot of very interesting theories, and a lot of things have been demonstrated, even going back to sort of the first papers published by Glagoff, regarding whether or not when plaques develop, if they develop by inward remodeling where the lumen becomes narrow, or they remodel by outward expansion of the vessel. And the thought is that the early process is an outward expansion followed by an inward remodeling of the vessel. And so this is a good sort of measurement that gives us a sense of what the ratio of the volume of the wall is to that of the lumen, and it gives us a sense of the remodeling. So this is sort of our remodeling ratio.
So when this index gets larger, is that a sign of positive remodeling, as we say, for vulnerable plaques?
That's right. It's a process where the most earliest signs that we see with these plaques is that there's an outward expansion. And so this is a ratio that gives us a sense of that.
But next to this remodeling index, you looked for other features by MR to indicate vulnerable plaque. What were these other features?
So we took full advantage. MRI is a wonderful technique that gives us a lot of sense of tissue contrast and of different components within the plaque. And because this is a territory where we have operative specimens after endarterectomy, there's been a lot of, over the last decade, there's been a lot of work that's gone into validating that we can correlate histology with MRI findings. So on MRI, we are very good at looking at things that we looked at, including lipid core, the presence of calcification, the presence of ulceration within the plaque.
So maybe we should have a quick look at figure 2A and 2B. And can you explain that figure a little bit, or what we are seeing there?
So we have these patients, and these are patients who have both post-gadolinium and pre- and post-gadolinium images. that will give us a nice example of basically how we would contour the morphology of the plaque, as well as identify some of the signal characteristics, including things like calcification, or including things like the presence or absence of a lipid core. And so in these figures, we're just pointing out some of the ways that have been published in the literature, but just to show that we've done sort of a very similar thing, where we're identifying the presence of calcification and lipid core by these features with and without, you know, T1 and T2 weighted imaging, and with and without contrast, giving us a very good sense of what's going on in the vessel.
Yes, so when you look carefully for those figures, I'm intrigued by the outer contour of the vessel, because it looks like a ring outside of the lipid core, which is relatively bright, I assume due to gadolinium enhancement. Is this the adventitia? And is this what they call in vulnerable plaque in CT the napkin ring phenomenon, or ring-like enhancement around the plaque? How you see that?
So it's interesting, like we have on CT, we have the sense that different components of the plaque will enhance with contrast in different ways, and that sort of fibrous tissue might have a brighter enhancement, or that lipid core might maintain a lower enhancement. And so, yes, we're looking at a very similar phenomenon where that sort of fibrous adventitial tissue often takes up contrast and helps illuminate exactly where we're contouring. And often we also see some fat surrounding the vessel that will give us a sense of exactly, you know, where to put this edge and where we're looking at. So it's definitely something that it's a process that we're looking at multiple different features, but they're all providing us additional information. And there's very excellent correlation sort of across imaging modalities.
Yes, so how was the correlation with IMT, for example?
So when we correlated with IMT, we got very good ICC characteristics. So we felt very confident that we were looking at something that was a similar phenomenon. And it's a good question, because IMT by definition is the intimal medial thickness, and we're excluding that adventitial layer. In theory, IMT can have an improved sensitivity, at least in theory, because really you're looking at those, you know, two of the three layers that you expect to be expanded or to be disrupted by the process of atherosclerosis, where you're having some type of inflammatory or process that's causing an expansion or causing a disruption of sort of normal cellular layers. And so for us, you know, in MRI, defining that difference between the adventitial layer and the medial layer is more complicated. And so we're including the entire thing. And so we're adding in that sort of extra fibrous layer, which we don't expect to be as variable between patients, sort of regardless of disease status. But regardless of that, we still see excellent correlation. And I think that part of that is that, you know, MRI techniques are very robust. We can acquire a larger volume, and they're a little bit less, sensitive to having sort of perfect, perfect collection at the point of patient care. We see that there are these ultrasound labs that have, you know, an incredible track record. You know, they have extremely talented and good physicians and technologists that are working very hard and giving us very reproducible numbers. But, you know, MRI has this robustness sort of across sites, regardless of the experience and training of those operators, that allows us to acquire the images in a very reproducible manner, which I think helps a lot and sort of explains why we saw such great correlation, even that we're looking at the same phenomenon, and that these techniques are all very robust techniques that are telling us a very similar story.
Okay, so we have now discussed in quite some detail the imaging features, the things you were studying, but now it's interesting to discuss what was actually found in which vascular territory in the internal and external carotid artery, and what were the findings by IMT and the features by MRI, and what was most predictive? What was the main finding?
So the main finding was very interesting. It was that both the presence of lipid core and the presence of remodeling were both very predictive factors. The presence of calcification was also important. And when we did univariate analysis, we found that these were important. And the thing that we found most exciting is that when we did multivariate analysis, that in addition to those traditional risk factors that we talked about, those Framingham risk factors, when we combined both remodeling index as well as the presence of lipid core. Both of those factors both remained important and robust independent predictors of events. And so the added value of having them all together was what caused the greatest improvement in our sort of net reclassification or in our sort of identification of the patients who are at most at risk of having some type of event. And so that was for us the most exciting thing, because it tells us that, you know, all of these factors are important and they can all contribute to giving us a better prognostic score, a more sensitive tool for identifying the patients who are most at risk.
Very good. So maybe as a final point, we can discuss a little bit what you also discuss in your discussion, is the issue of the vulnerable plaque versus the vulnerable patients. So some people think you can sample one side and you know the plaques throughout the body. And other people may argue you have to sample individual sites, the coronaries, the carotids, or whatever, to understand the full extent of disease. Can you comment a little bit on that issue and that discussion point?
I think that's a wonderful question, and I think this is a debate that will continue to go on for a long time. It seems a little bit incredulous to believe that you take sort of 1 centimeter of vessel in a, you know, in people that have, you know, hundreds of vessels, hundreds of capillary beds, and that is going to be predictive of whether or not they have a cardiovascular event. I think that the carotid arteries are a very special site in the body because they are large arteries that are superficial and sort of easy to image. But beyond that, they're providing, they have this bifurcation in them that nature has created that sort of produced that rock in the middle of the stream where sort of atherosclerosis can collect. And just like, you know, a rock in a stream will collect leaves and twigs as it's flowing down the river, we have this bifurcation that's in the body and it's supplying your face, which is skeletal muscle, and it's a sort of a high resistance flow bed, and your brain, which is a very low resistance flow bed. And so it creates, you know, an area where there's a lot of changes in flow, there's a lot of changes in velocity. It has to be very carefully controlled in order to sort of provide adequate and important and perfusion to the, you know, one of our most important end organs. And at the same time, it's very vulnerable to disruption or injury. And so I think that the carotid artery is sort of an early warning post or an area in our body that has, because of its morphology, because of its location, and because of sort of what it supplies, like it's a very sensitive bed. And so if you're going to pick one place to sample, I think this is a great place to pick. Whether or not this predicts all events in every vascular bed, it's an interesting controversy, but I think that it is probably one of the most sensitive areas in our body. And so you only could sample one place, it's a great place to look. And the question of the vulnerable plaque versus the vulnerable patient, I think what we know that plaques can form in lots of different vascular beds. And I think that having this sort of early warning area that we can look at, if we see that there are changes and there are, you know, early formation of plaque, that we see those early changes with the lipid core formation, that this is something that is sort of an early sign that bad things could be happening in multiple places. And so, you know, I definitely think that this is a great place, that the carotid arteries are a great place to look. They have all the biology and the sort of the physiology to be that early warning place that we need to look at. And you know, because, again, nature seemed to create a place where they wanted us to have a peek because it's superficial to the skin. It's something that we have access to and we can look at it with multiple different modalities. And so I think the debate will kind of continue on, but it's a great place to start.
Okay, thank you. I think nature was smart to design a superficial spot for MR. So thank you very much for this interesting discussion, and I look forward to your publication. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is Herb Kressel, editor of Radiology, and welcome to the May 2014 Radiology Podcast. This morning we'll be speaking with the authors of a fascinating article, which is a feasibility study on in vivo chloride 35 magnetic resonance imaging in humans. And we're joined by Dr. Armin Nagel, a physicist in the Department of Medical Physics in Radiology at the German Cancer Research Center in Heidelberg, and his colleague, Professor Marc-André Weber, who is in the Department of Radiology at the University Hospital at Heidelberg. Welcome, Drs. Nagel and Weber.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kressel, for having us, and good morning.
Yes. So let's begin. Dr. Nagel, why do we want to study chlorine? What's the idea here?
Yeah. I remember a discussion about 4 years ago together with Professor Lehmann Horn, who is also author of this article, and he's a neurophysiologist. And we talked about what can we do next. And I said, from a physical point of view, it would be feasible to measure also chlorine. But isn't it just a counter ion of sodium? And do we expect to see more things than with sodium? And then he said, yes, definitely yes. And he does a lot of work with muscular diseases, and already came up with putative applications for in muscular diseases, because we can calculate, for instance, the membrane potential of cells, at least from a theoretical point of view.
I understand. And for this particular paper, what was the study rationale? What specifically were you trying to accomplish?
So we, as there was no data available about chlorine imaging in humans, we first looked about the image quality, about the signal-to-noise ratio. We optimized the imaging techniques. We looked at the relaxation times. And yeah, we started to acquire the first images in healthy volunteers. And then we looked at patients where we expected to see a difference in the chlorine signal.
I see. And from a technical standpoint, my compliments, because this is an exceedingly challenging technical venture. And in your mind, what do you think were the key technical challenges that you faced, and how did you address them?
Yeah. So the first challenge was that the chlorine was not available at our 7 Tesla imaging system, because there's only a list of 8 nuclei available, and chlorine was not among these nuclei. So we had to change the system together with the manufacturer, because the radio frequency of chlorine is about a factor of 10 lower than the radio frequency which is used in conventional proton MRI. And then we had to build coils for imaging of chlorine. And yeah, then we started to acquire the first images in phantom, and then we looked at the image quality in vivo in humans.
And I noticed that you use the 3D density adapted projection reconstruction method. And why did you decide to use a projection reconstruction method, and in particularly the 3D density adapted method?
Yeah. The relaxation times of chlorine turned out to be very short. So in muscle tissue, the relaxation times are even shorter than 1 millisecond. So you have to use imaging techniques that enable fast imaging and short echo times. And the 3D density adapted radial sequence enables a higher signal to noise ratio compared to conventional projection reconstruction sequences, and it's up to 80% higher signal to noise ratio compared to conventional radial imaging.
I see. So some groups have been using projection reconstruction for very short echo times in lung, for example, or other situations. So that's interesting. Now, I noticed in your results that both the signal to noise ratio was lower than for sodium, and the relaxation time measures were also lower than for sodium. So do you think this will affect the growth of future clinical applications? Does this mean that it's going to be harder or less valuable to look at chlorine in the future?
Yeah, it will be definitely harder because the signal to noise ratio is approximately by a factor of 15 lower compared to sodium. This is due to the physical properties of the chlorine nucleus. And so also the spatial resolution will be lower. So if you have an imaging technique with isotropic spatial resolution, you will have approximately by a factor of two larger voxel dimensions.
Okay, and what was the spatial resolution in the images you acquired in the legs and brain?
So in brain, it's much easier to image chlorine because we have a higher chlorine concentration, and also the relaxation times turned out to be somewhat longer, what makes it easier to image. And so in brain, we could achieve a nominal spatial resolution of 6 millimeters isotropic in an acquisition time of approximately 10 minutes. In muscle tissue, we had 11 millimeters spatial resolution. And there we decided also to use multi-echo imaging to calculate the relaxation times and to compensate for the fast T2 star decay so that we are able to quantify the chlorine concentrations.
Okay, I'm sure that people viewing and listening to this will sort of, it'll occur to them, is this something that's only feasible at 7 Tesla, or do you think people will be able to do this at 3 Tesla?
Theoretically, yes, it will also be possible to do it at 3 Tesla, but I think you gain a lot if you do this at a high field imaging system such as 7 Tesla, or even at higher field strengths. There are other systems available with 9.4 Tesla that should even work better. It depends on the question you have. So if you want to look at muscle tissue, the spatial resolution is not so crucial compared to if you want to look at a small lesion in the brain. So it depends also on the application. So for muscle, I would say it would be also possible to do it at 3 Tesla.
Good. Okay, Dr. Weber, why is chlorine a particularly important anion to calculate the membrane potentials for muscle cells?
Yeah, well, it's muscle cells have a very high conductivity for chloride. For example, we have this Nernst equation, and there, just having the extracellular and intracellular chloride concentration, we can calculate non-invasively the cellular membrane potential. And that's a really great thing to have, because otherwise you need very... You cannot measure it in vivo, only ex vivo. That's a great thing now.
So I understand that, but I'm not quite sure, and I'm sure our listeners would wonder, why is it important to calculate membrane potentials? How could we use this clinically?
Membrane potentials play a key role in certain diseases. For example, in muscle diseases, we know that there are ion channel diseases, also chloride ion channel diseases. We think of the autosomal dominant inherited Thompson type or the recessive Becker type. And these, the muscle membrane is a bit weak, and the muscle cell depolarizes, and the muscle gets stiff and weak, and the patients develop a paresis or muscle stiffness after certain triggers. We know also other ion channel diseases where, for example, in hypokalemic periodic paralysis, we have just examined patients in the radiology paper. They have a cation leak, so the cell membrane is so weak that both anions and cations can pass the membrane. So it's great to have instruments to study this.
So do you think this will help us identify patients with this disease, or categorize them, or follow treatment? How would we use this in a clinical setting?
Yeah, in this, for example, in this hypokalemic periodic paralysis, we know that these have a muscle edema, and this muscle edema will eventually destroy the muscle cells. We observed it also in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So we know rather a little about this, how these edema will lead to muscle cell degeneration. And we think that the ions play a crucial role in developing an intracellular edema, mm-hmm. because they these ion disturbances will be osmotically relevant, and they drag water into the muscle cells. And I think that's therefore interesting to study it, also to monitor treatment effects if you want to stabilize the cell membrane, and if you want to apply, for example, diuretics who wash out the muscular edema. Mm-hmm. And now we can measure chloride, and we can measure sodium and potassium, and now we have everything which is really important regarding ion channels and cellular conductivity.
Okay. Now, you also studied in vivo some glioblastoma patients. And how did the calculated values you obtained in terms of the chlorine levels compare with the results of others or known tissue levels? Was there a reference standard that you use? How do you know your calculations are in the right ballpark?
Okay, there's a little knowledge about chloride concentration in brain tumors. What we know is that, interestingly, glioblastoma cells have a higher expression of chloride channels. They may play an important role in the growth of the cancer cells and the migration of the cancer cells, and it's known that certain stages of the cell cycle, you need a depolarization, and therefore chloride channels play a special role. So from a theoretical point of view, chloride concentration should be increased in these tumors, but we only had animal experiments. So we were really happy to present you in vivo images of such a glioblastoma in radiology.
Well, thank you. We're very excited to be able to publish them. And the other group of patients that you studied, as we were mentioning, were patients with periodic paralysis. And you've sort of mentioned why chlorine is elevated in these patients and why it's of interest. Are there any other potential clinical applications that you can foresee using chlorine in these patients or in other groups of patients?
Yeah, I think especially it would be interesting to monitor these chlorine ion channel diseases like Thompson or Speckers myotonia, but also to better understand the development of edema-like muscle changes in patients with hypokalemic periodic paralysis. You have to know that there's not only one channel mutation, so there are several mutations and which have the heading is hypokalemic periodic paralysis, but there are different subgroups of patients. Some have edema, some have no edema, some develop a muscle weakness, others don't. We have no idea what's the reason for this, and I think with the use of chlorine imaging, sodium imaging, and potassium imaging, we can do really help the patients to unravel certain defects.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Well, Dr. Nagel and Weber, I want to thank you very much for joining us in the podcast. This was kind of a very interesting paper for me to review, and it has been a pleasure speaking with you about what you did and where this is going next. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was a pleasure to meet you.